I want to begin by saying that I am pleased to welcome Frick Bruni and Jennifer Steinhauer as they present A Meatloaf in Every Oven. Bruni, New York Times op-ed columnist and former chief restaurant critic, and Steinhauer, veteran Times reporter and food52.com Weeknights with Jenny writer, bonded over meatloaf. And their collaboration here is a lively exploration of the dish's history, ingredients, and possibilities. The authors have gathered recipes from politicians such as Minority Leader Nancy Pelosi, Senator Chuck Schumer, Speaker of the House Paul Ryan, and chefs including Bobby Flay, Mario Batali, regional variations from Europe and the Middle East, stories, anecdotes, and tips for meatloaf connoisseurs, and answers to a range of questions regarding condiments and spices. Publishers Weekly says traditionalists and more adventurous cooks will appreciate the South African Bobotai loaf, a lamb-based loaf incorporating tamarind paste, curry powder, raisins, a Granny Smith apple, and bay leaf-infused milk, calling A Meatloaf in Every Oven a terrific collection that deserves a look from meatloaf lovers of all ages. Without further pause, I present Frick Bruni, Jennifer Steinhauer.
We were cracking up back there. I never thought I'd do a book event that began with the words meatloaf lovers of all ages. this is a little bit out of, well, less out of character for you than for me, but I am shocked to be here talking about a cookbook, partly because for much of my life I've been an extremely timid and borderline incompetent cook. And in fact, one of the best illustrations of that comes from this city of DC. I used to live here back in, I think the story I'm about to tell you is from 2000, late 2000. I was based here for the New York Times when I covered George W. Bush's presidential campaign. And those of us who covered it really spent more time in Austin than DC. And so there was very little cooking happening over the course of a year or more. After I got back to DC, I thought, well, I really need to cook a little bit more. I need to entertain people. And I remember having a dinner party for the Oscars that year. This was in my home in Georgetown. I remember among the guests was John Dickerson and his wife. And I thought, I will make my mother's meatloaf because that's fail-safe. What can go wrong? I was simultaneously trying to make mashed potatoes and some other things. The microwave was occupied with something. I needed some softened butter. My butter hadn't been softened. I thought, what can be hurt if I just throw it in the oven briefly with the meatloaf? Because I'm going to retrieve it in exactly a minute. The doorbell rang. I mixed somebody a martini. I mixed myself a martini. Maybe I drank half of this martini. And the next thing I know, someone said, Frank, there's a fire in your kitchen. And the stove was billowing flames. This caused an electric short. I had to throw water in the stove to get the flames to go away. And thus my guests ate a half-cooked, soggy version of my mother's meatloaf. I like to think, you're looking at me in horror.
Because the moral of that story was that you left the butter in the oven too long. Like, what kind of person puts a stick of butter in the oven to begin with?
The moral.
That's more sort of the basis here for this problem.
This is a story of redemption, Jennifer.
It is. It's true.
Would you let me get to the redemption?
Yes.
My
go on.
Point, which is actually a pretty vague and meandering point, is that this book for me began not in meatloaf glory, but in meatloaf shame. And meatloaf became sort of my act of betterment. I'm going to just end there because you're really looking at me strangely, and I think...
No, I think, meatloaf does bind the nation. We have discovered that. Meatloaf is bipartisan. Meatloaf is ecumenical. Meatloaf is something that we all can share and love and be, in fact, the food of redemption. Definitely.
I agree. That's all
you got? I just don't want you to put butter in the oven anymore. I don't want you to put anything in the oven like that.
I have never put butter in the oven again since.
Great,
but,
that's good.
And my mother's meatloaf leads off this book, and I had subsequently much better experiences with it. Part of the reason I tell that story, and part of the reason I admit that I was not always a very confident or good cook, is because what I love about meatloaf, and the reason I cooked so much meatloaf over the years, is I think it is the most approachable of foods to work with. It has a lot of margin for error. It feels really forgiving. It's not like if you screw up the ratios, it won't rise. And it feels like child's play. I mean, the best way, and we can talk, we'll take questions later. We can talk about meatloaf technique. We can talk about Congress. We can talk about Trump. It seems to me that in this day and age, 5 minutes cannot go by without the uttering of his name. So Trump, Trump, Trump.
Trump has a meatloaf that he likes a lot. He serves it at Mar-a-Lago. It's not in our cookbook.
It's not in our cookbook, no, no. And we've looked at the recipe and we're not that impressed. But Trump is on the record saying it's the greatest meatloaf, amazing.
The best meatloaf that
shocking
there is.
That he would think about something associated with himself in such superlative terms. Meatloaf, I think, is something that everyone feels comfortable making. You get your hands into it. When we started this book, how many meatloaf recipes did you already have?
I only had a few meatloaf go-to recipes, which one of them actually was a meatball gone wrong, basically, where I took too much meatball batter that I had and made it into a meatloaf. But Frank and I started talking. We talk a lot. Most of our friendship has actually taken place not in the same city. We both lived in New York, then Frank was in Rome, then we were in New York again, then I was in Los Angeles, now I'm in Washington, he's in New York. Most of our relationship takes place on the phone. We have what we call our Saturday dishwasher time. We both unload our dishwasher and talk. And we talk frequently about what we've eaten out or in, and we started talking a lot about meatloaf and Frank's comfort blanket of meatloaf, that he could take meatloaf to a dinner party. Didn't you even win a meatloaf contest?
I did. No, but I just want to back up and say, I want to know, you know, I don't only unload my dishwasher on Saturdays. It happens at other points of the week.
Do
as
you
well.
Unload your dishwasher talking to other people? Because that will upset me. Actually.
No, but you
okay.
And I, you and I,
just,
are, you,
you that's
and I,
our thing.
You
the
and
dishwasher,
I are inveterate multitaskers, and I go toward the dishwasher, and I think, Jennifer, I can kill two birds with one stone. You know?
His dishwasher is a lot better than mine too, which is another kind of issue that we have. So, I have a little bit of dishwasher envy. It's a little quieter. So we did talk a lot about meatloaf and our shared love of meatloaf.
How quiet my dishwasher is.
We've discussed this.
Have you stood there in the kitchen? And
I've been on the other end of the phone. There's no sound from your dishwasher. Okay. So we've discussed our love of meatloaf. We discussed your mother's meatloaf.
Yes.
We've discussed the meatloaf you won a meatloaf contest with. We discussed my
meatloaf. Oh, that was one of the paces in the journey toward this book was I went to a Times colleague of mine, who was the TV critic for many years, Alessandra Stanley, maybe you've read her work, maybe some of you know her. She decided one night for her dinner party she would have a kind of meatloaf contest. Everybody had to come with their best meatloaf. And I thought about making my mom's meatloaf, and instead I made a loaf that is in the book, and that you can actually see Jennifer and I making with Mo Rocca on CBS This Morning tomorrow morning, and eating with Mo Rocca. And it's in the book. It's called Greek Loaf with Lamb and Feta, and it's an all lamb loaf. We love lamb loaves. We have a whole chapter of lamb loaves. It's got feta, mint, rosemary, etc. And I think five different people brought five different meatloaves to this dinner party, and the Greek loaf with lamb and feta won going away.
You were victorious.
Yeah.
I think all of you should eat meatloaf with Mo Rocca at 10 o'clock in the morning, so, by the way. I just want to suggest that as an activity for you. So the thing about the meatloaf, when we started to build out the meatloaf, well, first of all, I had written another cookbook. I was kind of in the market for doing another cookbook a little bit. And Frank said he had always thought there should be a great volume of meatloaf. And why don't I do this? Why don't I steal his idea and do a meatloaf cookbook? And I said, it would only be fun if you did the meatloaf cookbook with me. Plus, I want your award-winning meatloaf. I don't want to pay you for it. So why don't we just share this meatloaf?
Like I would have charged you.
Things happen. So I want to just make sure that we can share all of our love of meatloaf and develop more recipes around meatloaf. We weren't totally positive that we could come up with what an average cookbook has, which is at least 40 to 50 entrees, if you know, a subject cookbook should have about that many recipes. But we started out, we explored, we read a lot about meatloaf. We read about the history of meatloaf, which there is an interesting history of meatloaf that we explain extensively in the book. I want you to read every word of that part. And all of it, there'll be a test. And then we started to realize that we could do meatloafs from around the world. What other cultures had loaves, they had staples in their diet were similar to a meatloaf. Or we could take the flavors and spices of the world and turn them into meatloaves. And then I took, we got a lot of friends to test them. And I work in the Washington Bureau of the New York Times, and so I dragooned many of my colleagues to cook meatloafs over the weekend and then give me their notes. And this became a thing where everyone had to talk about their meatloaf, and we would have these just dreadful meetings on Mondays where we all talk about the news, and we would kind of digress into meatloaf, and that was really good. So meatloaf was really very much a sharing activity with my colleagues, and you had a lot of friends across New York City who were willing to cook for you as well.
I did, and I became obsessed with the idea because, Jennifer, I think you developed one of my favorite recipes in the book, which is called the taco meatloaf. And the taco meatloaf, it's this astonishing thing because if you close your eyes when you're eating it, you would be absolutely convinced you were eating a hard-shell beef taco. And that's because one of the things we learned in our meatloaf journey, and we hope all of you will learn on the meatloaf journeys you're about to embark on. So I just had to extend that metaphor a while. Is you can use a lot besides breadcrumbs in meatloaf. The world of binders is infinite and varied, and so we have meatloafs that use crushed potato chips instead of breadcrumbs. The taco meat, farro, cooked white rice, crackers. The
corn
taco
flakes,
meatloaf
yeah.
uses crushed tortilla chips, and that taste is very distinctive. And so when you're eating it, you think you're eating a hard-shell taco. I became obsessed with the notion, and this is true in some ways, that any dish you take, you can translate into a meatloaf. You can transmogrify it into a meatloaf. And one of my other favorite recipes in the book, which was the fruit of that epiphany, is a buffalo chicken meatloaf that, again, if you're eating it and you close your eyes, you could be convinced that you were eating a buffalo chicken wing that had been dredged in blue cheese. You make your own buffalo sauce for it. You use dark meat chicken. You stuff it with blue cheese. You use diced carrots and celery, because often when you serve buffalo wings, you have as an accompaniment celery sticks and carrot sticks. And so meatloaf is the talented Mr. Ripley of entrees. It can impersonate just about anything.
That's true. Since we're in Washington, I think we should talk a little bit about our political meatloafs and how those came to be.
Well, you were the engine behind that.
But you do have some good theories about the meatloaf as the mirror on the soul and how that was reflected through these politicians. So we were developing meatloafs, and we had chapters in mind of classics and meatloafs from around the world and meatloafs that, in fact, aren't meat. Well, poultry and chicken and turkey meatloafs, and then we have some vegetarian loaves. And
don't forget the meatloaf muffins.
Meatloaf muffins, which are actually made of crab and shrimp, made in a muffin tin. You can make any meatloaf in a muffin tin. I just want to put that out there. Vessels, lots of different vessels for meatloafs. The meatloaf muffin, very good thing. So Susan Collins, Republican from Maine, loves to cook. This is not a well-known fact about her, but she really spends a lot of time cooking. And sometimes I will see her in the hallways of Congress, and we'll squirrel off into a corner, and we'll be talking a really long time, and then I'll look over and I'll see a bunch of reporters going like this because they think she's telling me some secret thing when we've actually been talking about Blue Apron the entire time. and her various experiences with Blue Apron and how, you know, and anyway. And so we talk a lot about food. And at one point, I told her I was doing this meatloaf cookbook with Frank, and she said, I would love it if you would contribute my mother's meatloaf. My mother, as many people utter this statement, made the best meatloaf. Her mother's still alive, actually, in Caribou, Maine, making meatloaf. And so I said, great, let me try it. And I.
It's really Caribou, Maine?
Caribou, yeah. And I made this. She's from Caribou, Maine. So I made this meatloaf, and I tested it. It has horseradish in it, which is its kind of its special sauce, if you will. And I brought it to her office and I said, I'd like you to taste it to make sure this tastes like your mother's meatloaf. And we're eating the meatloaf and she said, this is great. This is really good meatloaf. And her staff at one point said, Senator, you have a speech? You have a speech? We're talking about meatloaf right now. And they said, no, but you're expected down the hall in an hour. She said, when we're done with our meatloaf, I'll let you know. Boom, the door shut. So it was like I really appreciated that she has her priorities straight, sensible senator, like that. So subsequently, a few months later, I went to go interview Paul Ryan. He'd just become speaker. It was with this intro interview. And he had done his Google or something and said, I saw you're doing a meatloaf cookbook. And I said, yes. And he said, really, my meatloaf is the best meatloaf. I kill my own deer, and I grind my venison meat, and I have a venison loaf meatloaf, and I'm happy to share it with you. And so then I said, fine, that's great, would love that. And then I was talking to Frank, and he said, gosh, we just need a couple more, and we'll have a whole political chapter. So we went on and asked Nancy Pelosi if she had a meatloaf. She had a meatloaf, in fact, made with bison. And then I thought, okay, name one more person. And I wrote to Chuck Schumer's spokesman, and I said, and this is a really weird question, but does the senator have a meatloaf? And he said, that is a really weird question. I can't imagine. An hour later, I get an email back saying, oddly, the answer is yes. And we can talk about, so there's four meatloafs, and that one is completely different than the others. That's a barbecued meatloaf surrounded by barbecue chicken. So that's a kind of, I'm going to call that winter fare. But you had a theory about how this is all very political.
Well, I first want to say that we're realists. You know, the book is realistic. We're realists. The Paul Ryan recipe does not begin step one, grab a bow and arrow and go into the forest. He may kill the deer for his meatloaf. We do not ask you to do that. I think it's hilarious because each of these politicians' meatloafs is a perfect mirror of who they are, of who they want to be. So Paul Ryan, obviously a big part of his personal mythology, is Paul the Hunter, and his meatloaf is venison. Chuck Schumer, big people pleaser, wants everyone to be happy. His meatloaf is basically 10 entrees in one, completely noncommittal. So we literally call it the omnibus meatloaf because it's like an omnibus spending measure.
And because we're dorks.
Right. But it's also true when we went to friends. Almost everybody's meatloaf, whether it's deliberate or whether it's accidental, is like a poker tell. It tells you so much about them, I think, don't you?
I do. So then what does Nancy Pelosi's meatloaf say about her?
So there's ciabatta in it because she's nodding to her Italian ancestry. Bison is a lean meat. She's in the Bay Area. She wants you to know she's all healthy, right?
Right.
There you go.
And then Senator Collins is practical.
Yeah.
Her loaf is practical.
Hers is the least pretentious, the most straightforward, the most like the person.
Correct. So what else about meatloaf?
Well, while Jennifer was rounding up the politicians, I was prevailing upon chefs.
That's right.
My past as a restaurant critic. When I was a restaurant critic, I couldn't get to know or socialize with any chefs, and I didn't, because you need to maintain a distance. But what happens is, if you're in that job for a while, as I was, as soon as you leave it, many chefs then kind of want to get to know you, befriend you, because you've been this enormous force in their lives, but you've been this invisible, sort of disembodied, distant force. And that was a very satisfying part of the book, because chefs are by nature very, very generous. There is something of a tradition of prominent cooks and chefs sort of cross-seeding, cross-pollinating each other's cookbooks. And so it was a revelation and just a real, real good fortune that I think every single chef except one that we went to and said, hey, do you have a meatloaf you'd be willing to share, contribute to the book, said yes. All of them immediately had meatloafs, which is interesting. Several of them took an enormous amount of time to develop meatloafs for the book. So some of them had favorite meatloaf recipes they'd never published and they were sitting on, and they just kind of dusted those off. Some of them, like Mike Salamat, does anyone know the restaurant Zahav in Philadelphia, which if you don't, yeah, you're not, the people who know it are nodding, like really. One of the finest restaurants in Philadelphia, and one of my favorite restaurants in the country is Zahav. And it bills itself as modern Israeli cooking. And Mike Salamanoff, the owner and the chef there, an amazing cook, and he's especially good with lamb. And he contributed a chapter, a meatloaf for our lamb chapter. A wonderful chef in Miami named Michael Schwartz. Has anyone here ever been to Michael's Genuine Food and Drink in Miami? It's another phenomenal restaurant if you're ever in Miami. He does a lot of vegetable cooking, and so we asked him in particular if he could give us a vegetarian loaf. And he was so serious about it, Jennifer was the one who tested this loaf as he kept on handing it in, that it wasn't, you tell that story about how many times we went back to him and how great he was.
Three or four times. I mean, we've tested the chef's recipes so you don't have to, because chefs have a very particular way of writing recipes. We were so pleased and grateful to have these recipes, but they're hard because they're not scaled necessarily for the home cook, so you have to kind of work with it and make it work. And his is kasha, and the loaf works very well now, but it was, when you don't have the fat of meat, sometimes you have some structural issues with having a meatloaf set up. So we had to work over and over again to make this meatloaf workable for a home cook and with these proportions. And he was so generous with his time. He went back three and four times, I think, to help us perfect that loaf. And it's a very good loaf for vegetarians who want to try to make a loaf. The one chef that I think I had contact with was Annie Myler, who has a very lovely little luncheonette place in Los Angeles called Clementine's. And Frank and I both used to eat there occasionally. We both, for bizarre reasons that have nothing to do with each other, had a friendship with Nora Ephron, who loved meatloaf. She liked all kinds of very unpretentious food, and we used to sometimes eat the meatloaf sandwiches there with her. And so the book is dedicated to her, and as sort of a nod to her, we made sure to get Annie Myler's meatloaf, kind of a classic.
Yeah. What recipe in the book surprised you the most?
I think, actually, I made it again last night. I couldn't sort of look at meatloaf for a little while. And then I didn't need that in my life. And now I'm inviting the meatloaf back into my life. And there's a loaf that's made with turkey, dark turkey meat, if you will, that's inspired by a restaurant, Charlie Bird, in New York, from a farro salad that they make. And we kind of tried to interpret the salad with the turkey. It has balsamic vinegar glaze with a honey glaze. It's just, people appropriately deride turkey. And you don't think it's a meat that's going to work well in a loaf. You think it's going to dry out. And something about the glaze and the farro, the nuttiness of the farro, I just love to eat that loaf. What about you?
The loaf that surprised me the most, that I love the best, you know what I'm going to say.
Are we back on the taco thing?
No.
Because that's a weird obsession that you have with that taco. That's like a kid's meatloaf. And you're really into it.
Like I said, meatloaf is mirror.
Yeah.
Jennifer developed more of the recipes in the book by far than I did, but one of the ones I developed that shocked me because I didn't expect it to turn out so well, and it's my favorite loaf in the book. In the book, it's called the cheesy chorizo loaf, and it's an all-pork meatloaf that has inside of it diced dry Spanish chorizo and diced manchego cheese, and then white rice, cooked white rice in place of breadcrumbs to kind of keep with the Spanish theme. It is so simple to make, and it is so incredibly delicious. And one of the lessons from it that can be applied wider, because we have other meatloafs that maybe use prosciutto or pancetta. If you use, or Mike Solomonov's loaf kind of fits in this category, if you use some sort of sausage, like chorizo, or some sort of cured meat in your meatloaf, you have a lot less spice work to do because the spices are already in that cured meat or that sausage, and it ends up being a great safe step. Back to the taco meatloaf, we recommend in that you use like a really good store-bought salsa. And again, that's a time and energy-saving thing because all of the things you would have to chop yourself are in that salsa.
The corollary to that, I guess, if you will, is that we were surprised by how much a meatloaf stands up to seasoning, especially lamb. I mean, lamb, you can just put one spice after another herb, after another aromatic, and it doesn't get lost. You still have that really lovely, special, kind of not quite gamey, lamb, earthy flavor that can have five or six different spices in there. And with beef, that's somewhat true also. You can really layer it on. So that's why you can be easy of hand with everything, except salt, to be a little more careful with that. But that's what makes meatloaf so easy to make. It's foolproof in many ways. What else you got for your favorite meatloafs? You like that blue cheese thing. That's an interesting one. It's very unattractive.
Yeah, no,
but it's very delicious.
Yeah. We have a meatloaf in the book that is admittedly gray in color. And it's one I developed, so I take full responsibility and blame for that. But it was so delicious. No one we consulted, none of the more sophisticated epicures than we, could come up with a solution to change the vaguely gray cast of this meatloaf. And the meatloaf is so delicious, it's called the home, I'm getting ahead of it. It's so delicious I didn't want to lose it. It's a beef meatloaf with bacon bits and blue cheese and sour cream. It's a health loaf, obviously. But it is really so good that when no one could tell us how we could improve the color, I said to Jennifer, well, let's just own the color. So it's called the Homey Homely Blue Cheese Loaf. And it's in the book. And I like that one a lot, except it is, in the context of almost every meatloaf being a nutritional apocalypse, this one is like beyond that.
Yeah.
It's like the 10 horsemen of the apocalypse in meatloaf form.
It is. It's a lot. And we also, because the best meatloaf is often the meatloaf sandwich, we have sandwich recipes with many of the meatloaves. We call it the next day or something like that. We suggest different condiments and different breads to serve these meatloaves with as sandwiches, and some classic sides with some twists, including our colleague Helene Cooper, who is also a very accomplished home cook. She loves cooking as much as she loves being a reporter, and she developed mashed potatoes with sour cream in them, which are absolutely fantastic. So you could just eat the potatoes if you want. Just go ahead.
Speaking of Helene's potato, is anyone going to be in New York in the next 3 to 4 weeks? A couple people. So if your meatloaf curiosity transcends this lovely afternoon right here, there's a restaurant in New York called the Nomad Bar. It's on 28th near Broadway, and they are actually featuring three of our meatloaves and three of our sides on the menu. It began Friday night. It's going for 4 weeks, and they serve them as slices in these beautiful Staub cast iron. It's 28th Street near Broadway. It's called the Nomad Bar. It's adjacent to and affiliated with the Nomad Hotel. And they've got on the menu the cheesy chorizo loaf, the Greek loaf with lamb and feta, my mother's meatloaf, and then Helene's mashed potatoes. And the two other sides?
The Moroccan carrots and the green beans, lemon.
And you can mix and match. You can get a meatloaf and a side for, I think, $22. And you can mix and match them, and they serve them. They make them look much, much prettier than I do in my home kitchen, I'll tell you that.
And there's one side that's available that came from a chef here in Washington. I forgot about this. At Barrel Restaurant on Capitol Hill, which is like a really fun place to go and drink bourbon and eat kind of homey kind of food. He has a macaroni and cheese that is unbelievable on that menu. And I was sitting at the bar one night eating that, And I said to my waiter, this is the greatest macaroni and cheese I've ever had in my life. How does he do this? How does he do that? And finally he said, I'll just get the chef to come out and explain it. So he came out in his chef whites and he explained the whole thing to me. And I said, would you be willing to put this in our cookbook? And he said, yes. And it's, you made it. You had quite a trial with that macaroni and cheese.
Yeah, I spent an afternoon making it and cursing at Jennifer by text, by G-chat, and by phone, because it uses 5 different cheeses, 2 of which were very hard to find, all of which combined were more money than I think I spent on my first monthly rent, you know, years ago. And there's a long, I mean, it's a solid hour and a half of vigilant stove work with a very long list of ingredients that are very expensive. And as I was finishing it, I said, never, ever again, and I've made it twice more since.
Yes, it's true. You haven't made it for me. I would like that, actually, to do that.
That's because when we get together, you do the cooking. You're the better cook.
No, I'd like to do that in your house, though.
Just set your oven on fire.
But that's a difficult recipe. The majority of these recipes, the vast majority of them, are actually, obviously, anyone who's ever made a meatloaf can make these recipes. They're very easy. They're entry level by and large. The only thing that we do differently than your traditional meatloaf is that we do saute our onions, which I know is not how most meatloaves are made. The meatloaf that most people grew up with had raw onions in it. We prefer the flavor and texture of sauteed vegetables, particularly onions. Some of the chef recipes are a little more challenging, but not all of them. And green beans, anyone can make green beans. So the macaroni and cheese, that's an outlier, I would say.
We could talk about meatloaf forever, but we wouldn't want you to have to listen about meatloaf forever. So why don't we open this up to questions? We can talk some more about meatloaf. We can talk about other stuff, whatever you guys want.
Politics,
et cetera. The
Oscars are coming up.
Footwear.
If you have a question, please step up to one of our 2 mics on the side, to right or to left.
Okay. I have a question. First question is, did you have a definition of meatloaf? I mean, does it have to be meat, and does it have to be in the form of a loaf?
Oh, I love you. That's such an excellent question. Both sides of that. Meat, no. It doesn't have to be red meat. We have turkey. We have chicken. We even have an ahi tuna loaf in there. The vessel thing, vessels, very important. Everyone thinks you have to make a loaf in a loaf pan. In fact, we prefer to make almost all of our loaves on a flat pan, like a cookie sheet, I even do mine in my cast iron pan a lot of times, because we like the way that the sauce kind of accumulates at the bottom of the pan. The only thing I would say, when you're making loaves that are not meat, particularly fish and vegetarian loaves, they really benefit from the loaf pan for structural purposes. But definitely, if you don't have a loaf pan, you can make a lot of meatloaves.
Mm-hmm. And what was the worst meatloaf you've ever had?
In my life? The worst meatloaf I've ever had? Wow, there were so many bad meatloaves. Not along the way in this book too much. I think I had a meatloaf. I would get meatloaf in college sometimes because that was one of the cheaper things on the menu. And I had 1 or 2 meatloaves in New York, I think, that were pretty much the consistency of like sports equipment. I don't know. What about you?
The worst one I ever had was one that I made several times for the book and that didn't make it into the book. Because when I was going through that phase where I was obsessed with the idea that I could turn buffalo chicken wings into a meatloaf, you could turn anything into a meatloaf, I thought there should be a chicken cordon bleu meatloaf. It just seemed to make sense, you know, because in a weird way, that dish already has meatloaf written all over it. I think I tried 3 or 4 different variations of it. All of them were inedible. And I kept on saying to Jennifer, well, I tried this time, I changed. She said, why don't you just give up on chicken cordon bleu meatloaf? And so that was the worst meatloaf, and it was my own doing.
Okay. I have a question. This is the first I've looked at the book, and I'm making your mom's meatloaf tonight. Just want you to know that. It's really remarkable, and it seems to me that this book would be perfect as a wedding gift, let's say, for some young couple.
Well, Valentine's Day,
exactly,
too.
Exactly, yeah, right.
I think Groundhog Day is under-celebrated as a meatloaf occasion.
And it's probably more available.
May Day.
But the question I wanted to ask you was, in terms of, let's say, a gift for a young couple just starting out, aside from this, what other cookbook might you recommend as something that would really be something for somebody who's just kind of learning their way around the kitchen?
Well, the classic in that genre, I think, is Mark Bittman's How to Cook Everything. Mm-hmm. I've given that to college graduates, people in their first apartment, and I have also given that as a wedding gift. It really is a beautiful cookbook that is basic without being pedantic or boring. It really does work on some of the very basic, you know, knife skills. And I mean, a lot of cooking for new cooks is really about how to shop and how to fill your pantry with staples that you have on hand so you can throw together meals at the last minute with very little or no shopping. So I think that's probably one of my favorite. I also like, I'm trying to think what year it is because there's so many versions of it, the mid-80s Joy of Cooking cookbook, which has some complicated thing. It was the one after they went off the rails, that one. It has basics, but it dips a little bit into what we call ethnic cuisine, but not so much. It's mostly American standards. I still cook those pancakes, Joy of Cooking pancakes, every other weekend. What about you? What cookbook? Do you have cookbooks?
Yes, of course I have. You do?
What's
I have a whole cabinet of them. I don't.
I know, but that you actually open them.
I used to use the New Basics a lot, because I think it's very approachable. I haven't gone in there in a long time, but years ago when I was sort of at the moment you're describing, I used the New Basics a lot. I also think almost everything Ina Garten produces is very approachable, and is written in a way and rhythmed or measured in a way so that there are plenty of accessible recipes among, you know, slightly more elevated ones. Don't you think so?
Yeah, I love all her. I made her corn muffins this morning.
I mean, they always work. There's a reason why she is as popular as she is, because I think she delivers.
I love the fact that you have a politics section in your book. I was wondering, we know that President Trump probably doesn't eat meatloaf, but did you consider putting together a potential, if Donald Trump made a meatloaf, what ingredients would be in it, recipe for the book?
Well, he does have a meatloaf at Mar-a-Lago, the best meatloaf that was ever produced. Like Frank said earlier, I think we were not that impressed with its originality or its elements.
It's just got onions, red peppers, green peppers, tomato paste. It's very, very straightforward. Yeah.
The imagined Donald Trump meatloaf.
Well,
this is really your territory. This is where you go crazy.
I think we need to have just a few Trump safe zones in this world, and our book is one of them. But also, I mean, part of it reflects timing. When we were putting together this book was pretty much set, done, you know, 6 or 7 months ago. Back in that distant era when people said, Trump is president? Never going to happen, you know. A lot has transpired since then. So as a matter of timing, it isn't a question that would have occurred to us necessarily. We did approach, I think, the White House to see if Michelle Obama would contribute a meatloaf.
Oh, you're right
and
about that.
That didn't go anywhere.
Yeah, that went nowhere. But that would have been pretty healthy loaf, I would think.
Yeah. This question is for Frank specifically, and Jennifer, I'd love to hear your opinion. But, sir, in your lifetime as a restaurant critic, you've reviewed some of the best restaurants in the world. So I was wondering if you could offer your perspective on what you think of the Washington, D.C. dining scene is today. What trends do you admire? And what places specifically are an example of where D.C. should be going and where it shouldn't be going?
Thanks for the question. I wish I could answer that in an intelligent way, but I can't. Because although I come to D.C. with some frequency, it's not usually in a manner in which I'm making sure to try the newest restaurants, the best restaurants. So I would be completely going beyond my knowledge, and I'd be fibbing to give you a verdict on the D.C. restaurant scene or to say where one should eat now. Now, Jennifer does eat out in her home city a lot, so she could give you a better answer.
I do. So before I lived in New York, I spent most of my career there, and then I lived in Los Angeles, which were two fantastic restaurant cities, food cities. And when I moved to D.C., in 2010, all I heard about was how much better the restaurants were. The restaurants are so much better, and you don't have to pay for tennis. These were the two apparent selling points of D.C. I could play tennis here for free, and I could eat in all these great restaurants. I have to say, at that time, I was pretty disappointed. I called it the $100 disappointment. Every night I went out with two people, it was always $100. It was exactly $100. It didn't matter what it was. Somehow it was always $100, and it was very, I didn't get it. Now, D.C. has since evolved into one of, because of our sort of recession-free economy here, one of the busiest restaurants cities. You know that there have just been restaurants that have opened and closed by the dozens since I've been here, and things that have remained. And I think one of the big flaws in D.C. restaurants, in my view, was the service. And there were good reasons for that. It's not really a restaurant service culture. It's not a place where people are acting and pretending to be waiters like they were in the Wactors, as I used to call them, in Los Angeles. And New York has a really strong professional fine dining culture. And it was never really either or here. It was like people who were working mostly at their NGO and then working at this restaurant. And the service culture didn't exist. I think Washington has really stepped up its game in that way. And I think the food here now is, there are so many amazing options. I really do appreciate that we have a lot of these top chef finalists here who've done better things than the others have done around the country. We have a couple of fine dining places that I think do make the mark. And then we've obviously gotten a lot of attention for Rose's Luxury, which was, I think, on Bon Appetit's Best New Restaurant of the Year at some point. So I think Washington has done a good job of reaching high and low at this point. And, of course, outside of the District of Columbia, when you're going to the suburbs of Maryland, Virginia, there's great Chinese food, there's great Thai food. So I think there are a lot of options here now. And then what you said, what should go away? I would like small plates to go away. I want them to go away. I want them to leave the country, not just the DMV. I want them to go another country that has not yet paid $12 for one bite of food. Go there. Don't stay here. That's probably a dining trend you've probably seen enough of too, right?
Yeah.
Generally.
Now I'm done with small plates too. Because, you know, in this, they bring the small plates. That first they tell you, okay, let us tell you how it works at this restaurant. Everybody shares everything. You want to say, let me tell you how it works at my table. I keep, you know, like, why are you telling us how to eat? But so the problem is it's not just small plates, but small plates happen in a context of, and you're going to all share everything. So God forbid you really like one of the things too much because you got your bite and you're in and out. You're done. It's gone. You know, I mean, there's something to be said for having a nice, whole, half, beautifully roasted chicken in front of you. And by the way, if you've never been to Barbudo in New York, it's the best half roasted chicken in the world, and one of the reasons I and so many people I know love it is because you get to spend quality extended time with your entree.
I think you're also hitting on this whole concept of instructions at all.
Yeah.
And have you been here before? What does it matter to you if I've been here? That's not your business. Why can't I have not been here. I have eaten before, though. I've eaten in a restaurant. I don't need any instructions on this at all.
I wrote a really nasty critic's notebook that a lot of chefs gave me grief for when I was restaurant critic in New York. It was about this exact issue. It was about being told left to right, you know, backward, forward, and all of this, you know, chew with your incisors. And, you know, I mean, like, you just really felt like everything was about here is how the chef intends it to be. And it's like, yeah, but there's a customer here who may want a different experience. And what about that?
I think we're moving a little away from that, somewhat.
When I was trying to eat meat but healthy, I was convinced I needed to eat liver, and I can't stand it. And so I experimented with a liver loaf. Did you have anything with liver?
So do you mean pate?
No, I mean a meatloaf with...
With actual chunks of liver?
Yeah.
Okay. And so I'm picturing this. An egg?
Mm-hmm.
Some Progresso breadcrumbs, maybe?
Maybe.
Some chunks of liver?
Mm-hmm.
An onion?
Mm-hmm.
I feel the strong involvement of peppers.
Could.
A couple of them?
It just never worked.
And it
for
never
me.
Took away the taste of liver,
it
right?
It never took away. Yeah. Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Ketchup. You tried ketchup. You tried other things.
Yeah.
And in the end, you sat down, you said, this is liver.
Right. Right.
Yeah. I'm not feeling that successful. But what's interesting about that is I do love pate.
Mm.
And pate is sort of a grown up meatloaf, isn't it?
Someone once called pate the Cinderella meatloaf.
Mm.
And to the question that was asked at the beginning about what makes something a meatloaf, does it have to have meat? Does it have to have loaf? In fact, there are a lot of things we eat that are essentially meatloaves that just take different form and aren't called that. A meatball mm-hmm. is a meatloaf that hasn't grown up.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like what a sapling is to a tree, a meatball is to a meatloaf. But really, it's you can take almost any meatball recipe, and by just kind of upping the binders a little bit, because a larger mass has to hold together, you have a meatloaf recipe. Middle Eastern kibbeh, or however you want to say it. When you look at what that is, that's ground meat, some cracked wheat, pine nuts. It's essentially the ratios and the makings of a meatloaf. And pate is essentially a kind of silken Cinderella meatloaf.
So I think what we're trying to say is you should just make pate.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other meatloaf? Any other topics?
Yeah. I'm sure that mixing the ingredients together properly, getting your hands into it is important, but how did you collaborate in writing the book? Who rewrote whom?
Oh. No one rewrote anyone, ever. And we're never rewritten or edited at all by anyone. That's an interesting question because, as you point out, we're not in the same city. Most of the chapter openings, I think we took turns kind of taking on the different chapter openings and then we would edit each other. But in the beginning, just the intros and the head notes, we would write for our own recipes that we developed. But we did the way the book is structured is really the way it happened, which is it's an email dialogue, basically. And, you know, Frank, Jennifer. And we literally did it that way. And we didn't use actual email. We did a Google Doc. And we would say, I have an hour. Do you have an hour? Okay, I have an hour. And we would sit together in our respective offices or homes and work in that Google Doc as if it were an email exchange and develop our discussion about each chapter. And those pretty much stayed intact.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you know, there's not a ton of writing in a cookbook. So, I mean, there's probably more writing in this one than in others because we just have fun with it. But at the end of the day, it's really more about just clear, concise recipes.
That work.
Yeah. And as for the Trump meatloaf, are you sure he didn't include gold leaf in the recipe at Mar-a-Lago?
It's possible. It's really possible.
What?
Russian dressing.
Russian dressing. That's good. That's good. Well, maybe you all should put together the Trump meatloaf.
Yes. It seems like there's a lot of motivation here, a lot of interest in a sequel. I think Russian dressing would be kind of good in a meatloaf.
Huh?
I think that would be kind of a good glaze, actually.
Russian dressing? I don't know. I was just
Is that gross?
I was just flashing on... How do you say his last name? Puzder or whatever. Mm-hmm. He could put the meatloaf in a bikini in keeping with his personality.
I love it. That's good.
All right, well, thank you so much.
Thank you all.
Thank
if anybody wants to
much.
Sign a book, we're here.